tell my mom when I was little that I'm Cinderella. All I ever do is work.
You don't care about me.
Yeah. You had that poor me thing.
Poor me. It's horrible. I throw it out there every once in a while. Oh my gosh, that's horrible.
Yeah.
Ran away from home.
She was a rebel. The only daughter, too, huh?
Wow. Oh, you were your family's Eden.
I was not sweet like Eden.
Couldn't find my way in, so I was kind of lost.
Eden, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good to see ya. Come find a seat.
Yep. All right, can I sit with you?
Yeah. We'll put you in the corner.
You want to move down?
I'm used to sitting in the corner.
No, you're fine.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, but you're usually facing the other way when you're in the corner, right?
Yeah, usually I'm facing the wall. That's the position I'm used to.
He's not in trouble yet.
You want some coffee or
no,
juice
I'm good.
Or anything?
That's why I sat by Amy, because I wish you'd keep me under control.
You didn't offer me any coffee.
You know it's here. He hasn't been here before.
Yeah, but I'm your favorite.
How are you?
That's why I didn't offer to you.
Yeah. John, James.
Yeah.
Hey, buddy. How are you?
Good deal.
Hey, what's up this morning?
Very good.
There's a smile.
Is
that a
beating
good mood? Here's a toy of his.
He just was happy. He just woke up happy. And was like, I just don't feel like sleeping because I'm happy to see you, Mom. And so I was like, okay, I guess we're playing. Sounds awesome. And then he went back to sleep at 7. So I only got to sleep for like an hour after that. So he went to bed at 10, woke up at 4, and then he was up till 7. And then we had to get up at 8 to come to church, so. But I was running behind because he was puking everywhere and pooping everywhere. And doing baby stuff.
Unless it spent $619 yesterday on a battery and all. But
I'm going to get some coffee. And you are going to not fall out of your chair. He fell off the bed a couple of nights ago.
Me and Mitch put an arm over there. That shot that guy that over on the call scene.
He fell off.
Yeah. His tools.
I stuck him way back. And I went to go get his battery. And he hasn't been rolling for me. What? I don't know how he got off.
So he's like, I'm going to take his.
Yeah, so he did, and you can't hear nothing with the kitchen water running, and I heard it thump loud, and I was like, oh my God, did somebody just say, and in my mind, I was like, Bree just fell out, or something like that, so I turned the water off,
and it was yours that fell out.
Yeah, so I turned around and felt like everything was I turned around and went to go take off one of them, and it was like the distance from the kitchen to my room was like stretching out as I was going, and I ran in there, and he was on the floor on his back. Yeah, he was screaming so hard. And then like he got real sleepy after that, so I was like, oh my God, it was a good question.
Yeah,
I finally called yesterday.
Yeah,
I left $10 on the turbo card.
Baby
said,
what are we doing
though?
Somehow I'm minus 9 now.
And
I'm like, how did that happen?
I didn't get on it. I'm sorry. That
19
I paid myself.
I'm like, I don't even know how that happened. Well, because you're not supposed to
be. Hey, how are you?
No, Quincy
didn't pay.
So when they gave
Quincy
us,
I'm already in the hole. Cousin
everybody, I think.
Put my ear back into my rod wall and knock
like
on the
tree.
Yeah,
six,
he doesn't know what happened. And the cop said, well, maybe the ground shifted.
Wow.
You have your own
car.
Apparently.
Crazy.
Almost started singing. Nobody wants to go.
Yeah.
All right, guys, let's get started. We are a few minutes late. I just printed these out to kind of let y'all know that these are things available to you each week. Elijah, would you turn that music off? Of course, every Sunday here at 10:30. If you get sick, something happens and you can't join us in person, you can always hit Facebook Live, or Ross puts it on YouTube, like a couple hours.
Yeah.
It has to upload.
Usually it's about a half hour after the service
is
done.
So you can always catch it on YouTube. We have women's recovery. Maybe this is the time of year where we kind of start looking at weight loss or whatever, but anything in your life that the Lord's saying, I want you to put this aside and I want you to put me first in its place, then that is why you come to recovery. So you can commune with each other and we can say, hey, I have this in my life that the Lord's asking me to lay down. Can you help me with it? It can be anything. And then Tuesdays we have hometown friends. That's just for ladies to hang out. We do some things in the community. Sometimes we do Bible studies. Sometimes we just pray. Then Tuesdays also is the men's recovery. There at the Reunion Center at 7:30. I'm starting this week. There's the books. If you want to join, the books are back there by Joshua in the chair. This will be a 6-week study for ladies. And it's all about, it's 6 encounters with Jesus on healing, like painful hurts, maybe wounds that we've gotten from childhood or whatever. So this will be really good. That'll be here at 6:00 on Wednesdays. And then my friend Rachel Harmon, because she just got married, is starting a post-abortion Bible study. So you'll have to contact her. The location is only going to be known to her and to whoever attends. So that way, if you had an abortion and you don't, you know, no one has to know that you're going. So contact Rachel if you would like to attend that class. That starts in February. We're going to start Embrace Grace classes back up. There'll be one for single dads this time. Super excited about that. And didn't you say this Sunday we had a fifth Sunday, right?
Not this Sunday, this month.
Sorry. So, fifth Sunday this month, and that means we just get out in the community, and we've gone to Miracles and Blessings, and not Miracles and Blessings, Next Step Ministry. We've helped a widow in town. But we need y'all to look around and say, hey, we see this need. So if you see a need in the county that we could get together and work on this fifth Sunday of So, yeah, these are things that you can get involved in throughout the week. And Elijah, I have 2 pictures. One is, yeah, okay, you're ready to go. So, this is just the baby shower that we were able to give these beautiful ladies. We had that, it's been a while now, 5 weeks, 6 weeks ago? No, not that long.
I don't think that long.
Like 3.
That's what I was guessing.
6.
Okay. It's been a long time, but I just wanted to let y'all know that when you give to Live Oak, like, this is one thing. We were able to bless these beautiful ladies and their babies. And then, Elijah, there's another picture. I just wanted y'all to see how pretty it turned out. So, don't forget to give your tithes and offerings, because those are very important. There's the box down at the end of the stairs, or you can go to Live Oak Comanche.com and you can give online. So that's all I have. Let's pray. Yes.
Are the men still doing the poker?
There you go. I had that on here and he had me take it off, so.
Yeah, it's not an official church function or anything.
Okay.
It's just me getting together with whatever guys want to come along, and we're just gonna play some poker and enjoy each other's company, I hope.
And were you going to start that tomorrow night?
Yep, that's tomorrow night.
At 7?
Yep.
So, yeah, you want to come play poker. Mm-hmm. And it's just a hangout, and it's really more for men who don't know Jesus. So it's a, hey, just come, get comfortable, and, you know, that's a good way to get to men to get to know you. Okay, let's pray. Lord, first of all, I just want to ask you, Holy Spirit, to just be present with us in this room, that everything, the junk, I know a lot of us, we feel inadequate, unworthy, maybe stepped on, maybe used this week. So many problems, Lord, and I just pray that you'd help us to leave those at the door, and then as we come in and as we worship you, as we honor you, that you would be present here with us in this room, and that as we leave, we will leave as totally new people. We can just relax here and be ourselves, and then as we leave, we can put on the armor and go out and love people the way that you've called us to do that. So may you be honored and glorified with our worship this morning. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, you guys can stand. You can sit. Whatever you do feels comfortable to you. You just assume your position, whatever that is, and we're going to go ahead and worship. And if you want to change in the middle of worship and sit down or stand up or whatever, then do it. You don't need me for directions. So let's go ahead and get things rolling. We're going to start off with This Is Amazing Grace.
Conquer.
amazing grace, we have a wonderfully, awesomely, majestic God, and there's just no one like Him.
That's where we got your name from.
Thank you.
so will I next. God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of life. As you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets form. If the stars were made to worship, so will I. I can see your heart in everything. Every shooting star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, so will I. God of your promise, don't speak in vain.
Cheers.
That is a good picture of our God in one song. About as good as I've heard in a single song, anyway. Take a seat. Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you that you do make beautiful things, and that you change us. You make us into something better than we were, and I'm just so grateful for that. And I know there's a world full of people who are really honestly wondering if their life really could change at all. Yeah, I'm so glad that in you the answer is a resounding yes. God, you changed me. I know I'm not the only one in this room. So, be here. I hope you enjoyed the worship we have to give through song. And now just I pray that you'd enjoy the worship we have to give you through hearing and then hopefully in turn obeying your word. Thank you so much. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, guys. We started up a new series last week. Bibles work a whole lot better if you have them right side up. So, little things like that make a difference. And it's basically that we're going through the book of Colossians. And I really just wanted to take that because Colossians is a great book that really, the whole point of it is Jesus. It's who he is and how, who he is and what his work was there on the cross and what he did even before that, how that changes who we are and really who we should be. I guess we've come right down to it. And so we just kind of want to go through that. And so it came up with this name. I unabashedly stole it off of a t-shirt I had, or a hoodie I have. Jesus changes everything. And it's true. There's not a life he can't touch. There's not a life he can't revolutionize in the best way possible. And if we can just give our life to him and live as image bearers of God who are redeemed through Christ's work on the cross, then we've got it made. Not to say that life is easy. I'm not trying to say that. That's not what I mean by have it made. But I mean that it's just, there's a peace and there's a rest that comes from knowing who you are and who God is. And life just seems to flow after that a lot more easily anyway. And so we want to take a look at this. And a big part of the problem that we have, and honestly, it's true inside the church, far more true outside the church, but it's true pretty much, I think, no matter where you go, that we have kind of a low idea of God. Who he is in our brain is not as good as who he really is. And to some extent, it's always going to be that way. Because we will never, I don't think, ever fully understand God. And if we do, it's going to be after we have passed from this life into eternal life with the Father. And honestly, my personal opinion is that I don't think that we're going to even fully understand him there. We're just going to get the rest of eternity spent figuring him out and getting to know him better and better. And the things that we find mind-blowing now about, you know, 80 billion years from now is going to be, yeah, that's still awesome, but look at what I've learned. Look at what I know now about God. And it's going to be so much better. And a big part of the simple fact that we have this low idea of God, I believe, is the simple fact that we can't see him. I've never seen God face to face. If you remember back in the Old Testament, if you read that story, Moses asked God, "Can I see you?" And he said, "Show me your glory." And God said, basically, you can't handle my glory. It's overwhelming to the point of death. That's how wonderful and awesome it is. And so he said, "What I'm going to do is I'm going to walk by you. And I'm going to cover your eyes with my hand. And when I pass you, I'll let you peek through the cracks of my fingers. And you'll see basically the train of his glory is what it calls it. Like the idea of a wedding train on a wedding dress. It the same majesty that is supposed to give to the bride is based on this idea of God. That God is so glorious that his glory follows after him. It echoes in the steps that he's taken. And so this is our God. He is awesome. He is holy. He's impeccable. He's divine. He's flawless. He's omnipotent. He's omniscient. He's omnipresent. I saw a list today of guy who put together 280 words to describe God, and it doesn't even cover the tip of the iceberg. God is so much better than anything we could ever describe or say or paint or create or do whatever. All our best efforts just fall short. That's a God I want to worship. A God that I can't have a hope of understanding while I trod on this earth. A God that is beyond my ability, beyond my capability, who understands things on a level that all of humanity never really will. Who wrote the laws of physics. All this and more. That's God. And honestly, if I had to use just two words, I couldn't even get it down to one. If I had to use just two words to describe God, it would be utterly different. Because God is so completely different than anything we've ever experienced anywhere at any point in time that he's... Theologians like to use this term, God is completely other. So whatever you've known, whatever you've experienced, whatever you've imagined, God's better, God's different, God's just other. There's no way we can hope to describe him. And our words fall short. There's nothing we can do to try to describe God fully. We sing some good songs. That song, So Will I think is about as good a description as I've seen of God in a single song, like I said. And there's some great songs out there. But he's just indescribable. He's that awesome. And Jesus, simply put, is the clearest picture we're ever going to get of God. He described himself fully enough in the Bible so that we can know him. We can know him not just as God, not just as Father, but as Savior, as Lord, as a very intimate person who created us to be in a very personal relationship. He really does want to be the best friend you've ever had. That's what he created us to be. And so he doesn't need us, but he most definitely wants us. I've been doing worship music in a musical capacity anyway since pretty much as long as I've been in the middle, legally speaking. I started playing music when I was 18, and I know I played probably several hundred songs over the years. And there's some great ones, ones that I just still love. And I get, at least right now, for right now, I am in charge of music here at church since I'm pretty much the only musician. So, but yeah, I'm open to someone taking the job. Hint, hint. But no. I got to find the right person for the job for sure. But regardless, I get to pick out the music for now. And while I don't pick out a single song that I don't really like, I have intentionally left out a lot of the songs that I genuinely love. That door likes to blow
open. Probably
just
going to have to leave it open today.
Yeah. You might have to
dead. You can lock it, actually. Yeah.
Lock us in. We're not going anywhere. Not till I'm done, anyway.
Captain Volume.
Yes, exactly. With the lock in easy reach. But anyway. Point is that there's basically sub-genres of worship music, if you're not really familiar. And there's one, and it basically comes down to what the point of it is. Like, there's some worship songs that we sing that are kind of prayers asking God for something. There's songs that praise God for what Jesus did on the cross and things like that. There's songs that praise God for what he did as far as miracles, whether it's what Jesus did or what God did back in the Old Testament, something like that. But I think my personal favorite classification of worship music is just what I call high praise. And basically, it's just praising God for who he is. It has nothing to do with us. It has nothing to do with what he did on the cross, except for that it proves his character of who he is and what he can do. And that kind of song just gives me goosebumps. I'm getting goosebumps right now just thinking about it. God is so magnificent and awesome. There's just no way on earth that 100 billion songs could praise him enough. And if every single person who ever lived or ever will live sang God's praise from birth to death, it still wouldn't be enough. That is God. And Colossians is a book that's all about Jesus and who he is. And we're going to take a dip into the deep end of the pool today in Colossians chapter 1. And basically, just here's what we're talking about. Jesus is our picture of God. It's closest we're going to get to knowing who God is. So let's read about him. We're going to start off in verse 15. So Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. Here we go. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead. So, he is the first in everything. For God, in all his fullness, was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth, by means of Christ's blood on the cross. This includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. Yet now he's reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. As a result, he brought you into his own presence. You are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. But you must continue to believe this truth and stand firmly in it. Don't drift away from the assurance you received when you heard the good news. The good news has been preached all over the world, and I, Paul, have been appointed as God's servant to proclaim it. That's as far as we're going to be going in this. But this is it. This is one of the most magnificent descriptions of Jesus in the Bible. It's a shallow dive into the deep end of the pool. And I just love what it goes through here. And Jesus is our picture of God. It goes in and starts off, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. Let's just start there. I want to go ahead and flip back. I'm going to do some referencing here to the book of John. See if I can find it. John chapter 14. Beat me there, more power to you. John 14, verse 9. All right, there it is. I'm going to back it up. Here's one of verse 8 is where I'm going to start. Philip is one of Jesus' disciples. He's traveling with Jesus for years now. So, Philip knows Jesus about as well as literally anyone on earth could. Here we go. Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Now, right there, I got to stop, because that right there is a good request. I just want to see the Father. I just want to know God. I want to be in his presence. I want to know him, understand him, and therefore, I can't help but fall more in love with him. So, in my mind, it's a good request. But Jesus still brings Philip to task here. Says in verse 9, Jesus replied, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and yet you still don't know who I am? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So why are you asking me to show him to you?" Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? So, that right there, Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. There's this idea in the Bible. The word itself does not occur in the Bible, which is Trinity. It's the idea that God exists in three persons. There's still only one God. There's always and only ever will be one God. Singular, unique, different. No one else like him. Although our hearts are basically factories where we make these idols that we can call gods. Sometimes we literally made idols in the past, and some people still do today. And so we make gods in that sense. But we also make gods out of people, places, and things. If it's a noun, we can make a god out of it. And we do. Some people worship money. Some people worship power. Some people worship authority. Some people worship their own body. Some people worship their spouse. Some people worship their kids. Some people worship their car, person, place, thing. We can worship it. We do that all the time. But there's always and never been only one God. And God is in three persons. The Father, the Son, who is Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. And so these three are one and yet distinct. It's a contradiction in terms, and I can never hope to explain it. There's been illustrations of three circles where you draw them and they're kind of all overlapping. You know, they're called, what are they called? Venn circles? I think Venn diagrams these days, where you see circles overlapping, and that's where two things meet and coexist in the same way, but there's still things about those individual items that are unique. Well, people try to describe God with that. It still falls short. People try to describe God with a three-leafed clover, you know, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one for each leaf, but it's still only one plant. Well, that still falls short. There's nothing human, because again, God is so completely different than anything on earth that he can't be described well. That's fine by me. But Jesus is saying, if you know me, you have known the Father. So right there, we see the character of God. We see Jesus' love, his compassion. We see when he gets angry, the things he gets angry about, the things he gets kind of short with about, the things that he feels the need to correct, like he did with Philip. All that stuff, we see it in him. We see his power. We see him performing miracles like healing lepers or big stuff like calming the storm. I mean, commanding nature blows my mind. That mid-storm, it just suddenly it's a calm sea. But that's not enough. He raised people from the dead, too. This is the sort of thing that God has done throughout the whole Bible. But we see it personified in Jesus himself. So, we see that. In Colossians chapter 1, God is the visible image of the invisible God. It goes on and says, he existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. He made it. I mean, it was Jesus. He was right there. He was an integral part of it. You know, it wasn't just the Father. It wasn't just the Spirit. You know, if you look back in Genesis chapter 1, you see that the Spirit of God hovered over the waters of the earth before it was formed into what we know. It doesn't mention Jesus directly there. But it does in John chapter 1. This is an amazing, one of my favorite scriptures altogether, John chapter 1. And I'm just going to start at the very beginning. So John 1:1 says this. It says, in the beginning, the Word already existed. So right there, the Word is Jesus. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with him. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. God sent a man, John the Baptist, to tell about the light so that everyone might believe of his testimony. John himself was not the light. He was simply a witness to tell about the light. The one who is the true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. That's an amazing passage. I love it. And it's basically the point I really want to draw from that is that Jesus made it all, and meaning was the Word, and the Word created this world. And that Word became flesh about 2,000 years ago. And he had a heart that beat just like mine and yours. He breathed the same air. Is it kind of wild to think that you guys might be breathing the same oxygen that Jesus did? Did you ever think about that? Statistically, it's pretty likely. I'm not saying you get a whole bunch of it, but it's there. So, at any rate, he is our creator. He's always existed. I lost my place in Colossians, so I gotta go back. You'd think after 44 years in church, I've learned to keep my finger in the main passage, but it doesn't always work that way.
Or your weird bookmark thing.
Yes, my weird bookmark thing. Yes, that would work too. Alright, so we see he's always existed. Colossians chapter 1, let's see, it's verse 17. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Now I'm going to flip back into the book of John. If you're wondering why we're going to the book of John so much, it's because, again, Jesus is God. If you know Jesus, you know God the Father. You know the Holy Spirit. And the Gospel of John was kind of written to help us understand this fact that Jesus, while human, very human, is still very God. And so that's kind of the main point of it. So, going to John chapter 8. John 8:58. Although I'm going to back up little bit. So verse 53. This is the Pharisees talking to Jesus, and he says, "Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died, and so did the prophets. Who do you think you are?" Jesus answered, If I want glory for myself, it doesn't count. But it is my Father who will glorify me. You say he is our God, but you don't even know him. I know him. If I said otherwise, I would be as great a liar as you. But I do know him and obey him. Your father Abraham rejoices. He looked forward to my coming. He saw it and was glad. People said, "You aren't even 50 years old. How can you say that you've seen Abraham?" And if you didn't know, Abraham came, you know, like a couple thousand years before this. So 50 years is a small piece of that pie. They're basically saying, "Jesus, what you're saying is utterly unreasonable. How is it that you're not lying?" Well, Jesus answers them. Verse 58, Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, before Abraham was even born, I am." Now, that is bad grammar in English, but people he's talking to understood fully what he was saying, because he wasn't just saying, "I existed before Abraham." No, because what he did there is he took God's proper name. The name when Moses himself asked God, okay, who do I tell your people sent me? Basically, I need a name. I need a handle I can put on God himself so that I can go to your people and they'll believe me that I'm being sent by you. And God said, I am that I am. So basically, he was Popeye before Popeye ever existed. There's no one else like him. He is who he is, and there's nobody comes close. And so for Jesus to turn around and use that turn of the phrase, that same phrase, to people who fully understood, because make no mistake, the very next verse, at that point they picked up stones to throw at him. Jesus was hidden from them and left the temple. So they picked up stones to kill him where he stood, because in their mind, he's committing blasphemy by claiming to be God. No small thing. So, he has always existed. He wasn't born. He wasn't the first human created. He wasn't just a person. He was God. So he has always been. And you know, when we are reaching into eternity, you know, when we're 8 quintillion years from now, we still won't have existed even half as long as Jesus has. You can't cut infinity in half and have anything less than infinity. So, that's Jesus. He's also the head of the church, we see in Colossians. Verse 18 says, Christ is also the head of the church, which is the body. He is the beginning. He is supreme over all who rise from the dead, so he is first in everything. Jesus wasn't the first person raised from the dead, but it's talking about first in the terms of preeminence, that he is above all, that he has authority over all, and he's going to lead his entire church. Everyone who's believed in him is going to rise from the dead. When we have a belief in Jesus that changes us, changes how we act, changes what we do, that's when we know it's taken. When Jesus is not just the guy we're looking to save us, but when we're looking to him because he has complete authority over our life, because we have surrendered everything to him, we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we're going to rise from the dead someday. It is simple fact. Jesus himself promised it, and he keeps his promises. All right. So Christ, we see also, Christ is first in every way. That's what it means when it says that he's first in everything. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth, by means of Christ's blood on the cross. So Jesus' act on the cross made us clean, made us holy in the sight of God, so that we could, like it goes on and says, this includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. Yet now, he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ, in his physical body. As a result, he's brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. Do you guys think of yourself as holy? Blameless?
No.
Me neither. But, simple fact is that when the Father looks at us, he doesn't look at me and see Ross and all my works. He sees Jesus Christ, God himself, and all his works. That's what the cross did. It was a total exchange. Christ took all of our sins so we could take his righteousness. I can remember talking with one person who believed that Jesus was just a human. Yes, the best human ever. A perfect human. But you know what being a perfect human being earns you? It earns you your place in heaven. And if that perfect one dies, well, he goes to heaven. His life, a human being's life, can only pay for that human being's eternity. So if, for some reason, a baby was born today that lived a perfect life, that person would die and go to heaven. And he would earn his own place. But if he died on a cross, it wouldn't be anything significant. It would just be the end, tragic end of a flawless life. But an infinite God, he can cover a very huge amount, but still finite amount of sins that you, I, and every other person has done. Only God could pay the price. No human ever could. That's significant. So, he reconciled us. He made us clean inside of God. He made us holy inside of God. He reconciled us so that we can have the relationship we were created to experience with him. So that just brings me to the point to simply say this. Jesus is better. He's better than anything and everything we've ever experienced or could experience. He is better. He's better than we can describe. He's better than we can imagine. I remember this song several years ago. It came out called I Can Only Imagine. And it basically just raises this question of when I get to heaven, what am I going to do? And I experience God's presence. Am I going to just run and go hug my Father whom I love? Or am I going to fall down in worship in awe of his presence? And it's a valid and good question because there's that love, there's that intimacy with God. Personally, my thought is I'm going to be blown away by his awesome presence. I'm going to fall in worship. There's going to be time for hugs and worship all through it, but I think just that first initial experience is going to be overwhelming. And I won't be able to do anything but fall in worship. I could be wrong, but that's my thoughts. But when we get a view of who Jesus really is, who God is, when we understand who he is, and when we understand that we were created in his image, it changes who we are, what we understand about ourselves, and therefore it should absolutely change how we do things, why we do things, and what we're doing. I mean, just everything. It changes. Jesus changes everything. When we properly understand them, it absolutely happens. So, Jesus is completely different. He's utterly different than anything we've experienced. But you know what? The best part of all that is that Jesus is better. I think that's where I need to end. Lord God, I come to you and I'm just humbled by your presence. I'm humbled that you care about me. I am just a handful of atoms that you created. And if it weren't for the fact that you made me in your image, I wouldn't be any better than a pile of dirt or a bucket of water or anything else. But God, you did make me in your image. And your image is a beautiful thing. Because you are awesomely majestic. I just don't have the words for it. No one does. God, I look forward to using the words I can for the rest of my life to describe you. And I hope that people see and get a glimpse, just the barest, smallest glimpse of who you are because of what I say and do. And I pray that's true for everyone here, that we all hold you in the highest esteem possible, that we are in awe. We revere you, but we are intimately in love with God. So, thank you so much. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. 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 All right, guys. I want to say thanks for coming. And as always, I love you guys. I hope to see you next time. Bye.